Good morning, everyone. Can I welcome you to the fifth meeting in 2016 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during this morning's meeting. No apologies have been received. Agenda item one is Ofcom's draft annual report 2016-17. The committee will take oral evidence on Ofcom's draft annual report, draft annual plan. And I welcome Sharon White, Chief Executive of Ofcom. And can I invite Ms. White to make a short opening statement?
Just to say, it's an absolute pleasure to be here. It's my first time at a parliamentary session here, and it's a great delight really for us to get some feedback and some commentary. As you know, the Scottish Bill will mean that there's a more formal and structured role for Parliament on our annual plan, and I'm have to say very keen as a chief executive who's very focused on ensuring that communications work for consumers, and there are all sorts of issues and priorities for us around access and availability, speed of service, big issues of rurality, which come to life particularly in Scotland, that we're very keen to get your feedback today so that we can ensure that the needs of the populace in Scotland are properly reflected. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. I'm very pleased to have you in front of the committee this morning. Perhaps I could kick off and just ask you, you mentioned the Scotland Bill, which is currently going through Westminster. That will bring about a number of changes to the way in which Ofcom operates in relation to Scotland. I just wonder if you could provide a short update on what progress has been made towards the agreement of what I understand will be a memorandum of understanding between the two governments on Ofcom's relations with the Scottish Parliament.
Yes, as you say, the Scotland Bill will, I think, further strengthen the relationship between Ofcom and Scotland. The memorandum of understanding, we are working very hard with colleagues both in the Scottish Government and with the UK Department for Culture, Media and Sports. I hope we are weeks away from agreement, but what that will do is set out some very, very clear formal structures for consultation, not least, as I think you know, with a Scottish member of the Ofcom board, which we see as a very positive step.
Can you say a little bit more about what difference you think that appointment will make to the way in which Ofcom operates and what the benefits will be for consumers in Scotland?
So I personally think it will be a big difference. As I said to you, my main priority coming in as Chief Executive is to really think about the sort of UK connectivity looking 10 years ahead. And although the market has been competitive generally, has worked well generally, there are still some very, very significant, I mean more than pockets, but significant parts of the UK, not least in Scotland, businesses as well as residential consumers. So I hope, if you take a very practical example of the universal service obligation, the issues around the Highlands and Islands will be very different from the issues, say, of the Welsh Valleys or of the city not spots that we have in London. There'll be different technological demands, different technological requisites. And I think having an Ofcom board member from Scotland that is able to speak to all of our agenda, but represent and understand the needs in a more granular way, I think is really important. And it's one of the reasons why I'm also increasing the size of Ofcom's presence in Scotland. We're setting up a new Edinburgh office, and I'm hoping to have more of our engineers and technologists and some of our other consumer experts closer on the ground here in Edinburgh.
And the Ofcom board member, can I ask you, do you see that role being very much Ofcom's person in Scotland or the consumer's person on the board of Ofcom representing Scottish consumers?
It's a bit of a fudge to say both. I mean, I think the most...
We're used to fudge.
I know, it's my civil service background. When I think about the representative of Scotland, I think the ideal candidate is able to speak both to the broader Ofcom agenda, and as you know, our remit is very, very broad, broadcasting, determining which parties and rightly due party election broadcasts all the way through to some of the telecoms issues, can speak to the broader agenda, but has got a real understanding and appreciation of the priorities in Scotland that can feed into the decision taking on our wider priorities. So whether I don't quite see them as a consumer champion of Scotland, but I do see them as somebody who has got the credibility of this committee, has got the credibility of the broader populace in Scotland. I think that's really critical.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of the memorandum of understanding, will that provide any detail on the positive engagement that Ofcom will have with the Scottish Parliament, with this committee, and what kind of issues will be covered off in that?
Yeah, very much. I mean, as I say, it's still up for debate, and I suspect some of the discussions are about how much more or less specificity there is there. For me, what's really important about the MOU is that it does set out a very positive agenda and a positive story for the engagement. So that's both at working level, but I hope that we can get into a routine where Parliament feels able to call us more routinely for evidence, where there is an early engagement on our annual planning, and where essentially it's a sort of ongoing dialogue rather than even a sort of sure. once a year discussion. So for me, having Parliament much more tightly knit into our engagement mm-hmm. and to our priority setting would be, I think, is really critical.
And what about the information that Ofcom provides in relation to Scotland? Would you anticipate that there'll be more detailed information yeah. at a local level, more granularity in terms of the data
yeah,
and
very
information
much,
that you provide?
Very much so. I mean, some of you may have seen a report we did last autumn called Connected Nations, which is, I think, I wouldn't say the start, but it's a sort of building up of our desire to have much more granular information. At the moment, we're now able to publish by postcode data for mobile availability, which in the past we haven't been able to. So some of you will have seen our mobile checker maps. You can now go in, tap your postcode in any part of the UK, any postcode in Scotland, and see whether actually you're able to make a mobile phone call and to compare different providers in your area. And so this is why I come back to the consumer, understanding what it is, what the connectivity situation is like for the individual consumer is an area that we are really keen to do. I'm hoping over the course of the next year to household level and not just to postcode level, because obviously for many people you're combining mobile wireless connectivity as well as fixed line. So that's a very strong yes.
Thank you. Can I ask you about the strategic review yeah. of digital communications that I understand is expected to report this month? What are the initial, I'm not asking you to breach the embargo, but can you give us a flavour of what the initial conclusions of that review are likely to be, which obviously Ofcom will be charged with implementing, and what will be the key benefits for businesses and consumers in Scotland arising from that?
Yeah. So what I can do is give the committee a sense of the sort of headline issues that we are covering, and clearly a lot of the sort of media attention over the last few months has been particularly on the question of Openreach and its relationship with the broader BT group, but actually the review is much broader than that. So our starting point is we're trying to step back as a regulator. We haven't done a strategic review for 10 years. The market's changed a lot in that period. And we're trying to look ahead over the next 10 years to set out as a regulator how we can best support markets, communications working for all consumers over 10 years. And so we will be looking at issues we've just touched on around availability. So, you know, what can we do working with government, working with industry to ensure there's universal access to a decent service? We will be looking at, and this is probably more of a question for urban areas than rural, but how can we maximise competition so that consumers, again, aren't just reliant necessarily on an incumbent or a single provider, but have got a choice of maybe two or three providers, ideally. We will be looking at quality of service, you know, as communications has become, I guess, what some people determine the sort of fourth utility. We all rely on it. Issues about customer service are really important. And so we will be looking at what as a regulator, what our role is there. We'll be looking at deregulation. So we'd like to think of ourselves as being a proportionate regulator. And clearly, given technologies change, you think about, again, this is not you know, is not an issue for much of Scotland, but in some parts of the country, mobile has become more of a substitute for landline use. Is there some scope for less regulation without leaving many, particularly the most vulnerable people, disadvantaged? And then, of course, we'll be looking at the question of Openreach again in the context of the consumer. So would the consumer benefit from a different form of separation between Openreach and the broader BT group? And we said when we launched our discussion paper last summer that we would be looking at four options: the status quo, the possibility of deregulation if there's more network competition for Openreach, the current model of functional separation, and then the sort of fuller, more structural solution whereby you would have a change of ownership.
Okay, that's very helpful. I'm going to hand over to my colleague David Stewart to ask some specific questions about the universal service obligation.
Thank you.
David.
Thank you, convener. And I should say at the outset that I represent, along with Mike McKenzie, the Highlands and Islands. So you can imagine that broadband's a huge issue there. I suppose in general terms, I would say that this is one of the greatest areas of contention among constituents, is speed of broadband, the intermittent issue about broadband. And I suppose the wider point I would make is that some constituents have argued that having a minimum broadband speed should be a basic human right. Perhaps that's slightly to overstate it, but I must say I'm very sympathetic with that. What's your general view of the constituents' views about broadband speed being a basic right?
I mean, I'm very sympathetic. I mean, whether you talk about broadband speed being a basic human right or a fourth utility, I think it's the same idea, which is, you know, if we were sitting in this committee room 5 years ago, maybe even 3 years ago, what felt like a nice to have has now become absolutely fundamental to people's ability to have community engagement, social engagement, and economic engagement. And I think about, you know, some of the sort of very interesting reforms taking place in Scotland on public services and move to digitisation. You know, without a decent level of broadband being available for both residential and business consumers, you know, it's not just an inconvenience. It has got potentially very serious deleterious impacts, both in terms of well-being, but also in terms of economic activity. Mm.
So the sort of examples I've been picking up is, if you take Western Isles, for example, you know, a couple have moved to the area, want to run a small guest house, and are using broadband for a booking system, and find that they just can't utilise that. That is a real constraint in economic development. I mean, would you accept that?
I completely agree. My MP's mailbag on a weekly basis, probably 90% of my of the sort of concerns that are raised are absolutely around broadband speed and quality of service. And I think that's why, I mean, Ofcom, we have been encouraging the USO, and I'm delighted that the USO has now been announced, and delighted that even in the course of the last year, because obviously there was a budget 2015 announcement of a 5 megabits per second universal service obligation, that was doubled in the Prime Minister's speech last November. And I certainly will want to work very, very closely with the government to ensure that gets implemented in a way that everybody has got a right to request a decent service and have it made available.
I mean, and in fairness, I think the Broadband Development UK funding to Highlands and Islands Enterprise, which BT are now developing, I mean, certainly that's been a huge boost. And obviously, we've had regular briefs about the work that's been carried out. And obviously, I welcome that. And but I think if you look at the Connecting Nations report in 2015, it talked about Scotland as the highest proportion of rural premises, that's 57%. They're unable to receive more than 10 megabits. Yes. So I think there's the issue about, you know, rural areas being neglected. And I'm sure this is an issue in England, Wales and Northern Ireland as well. But since we're in Scotland, I'll flag the Scottish issue up. I mean, would you accept that there is a real worry that rural areas are still losing out in terms of decent broadband speeds? Yes.
I mean, I think we're in violent agreement with each other. I think one of the reasons why we were keen to give more visibility to the availability issues, and it comes back to the convener's point about granularity, is to make clear that although the broadband expansion has been hugely positive for many people, there are still big chunks of the country, big chunks of Scotland, small SMEs, I think is another big issue, which for other historic reasons, you've got many SMEs who are sort of caught between not quite, you know, having a service for a residential consumer, not able to afford very high-end services, where there is still a big gap. And certainly as Chief Executive for Ofcom, one of my big priorities over the next coming period is to close that gap. And for me, the proper implementation of the USO, alongside the work that's already happening, BDUK, obviously Digital Scotland, Superfast, and some of the community initiatives, this patchwork needs to deliver universality at a decent speed. Yeah.
Could at least, what may seem as a left field issue, but has been raised by some academics with me, is about the sort of corporate planning across all services in government. Let me give you an example. Currently, there's quite serious increases in road building north in the A9, one of the longest, if not the longest, trunk road. The argument's been put to me is, well, when we're doing massive road building, why don't we lay fibre optic cable as a minimum across the country, rather than then it's dug up at a later stage? And there just seems a lack of corporate planning across departments and perhaps across governments. Is this something that's within your remit and responsibility, or is this something that's been raised with you as well?
So it's raised with us as well. I mean, this will be a, you know, my past life when I was at the Treasury, and this is very much as a feature of how the planning rules are implemented. But I think we're very aware, particularly when you are laying, you know, if you're 66% of Scotland is served by BT, 34% isn't. So you're talking about laying new web networks in a large, very large geography of the country. And that gets you in very much into practical issues of how many times do I want my road to be dug up? How many times do I want my streets to be dug up? And so although it's not our responsibility, we will certainly be recommending that the planning rules are implemented in a way which actually makes it more likely that you're going to get the networks laid. So in some other countries, for example, where you've got sort of utilities that basically open up their sort of ducts, for example, they say, dear providers, come in, you've got 6 months to lay your fibre, and then there's a moratorium for 2 years. And it then incentivises all the competitors to come in at the same time, and also demonstrates to residents they're not going to be going through sort of, you know, perpetual building works.
Quick supplementary.
Just on that area, I represent an urban area, so opposite problems for my colleagues from the Highlands and Islands. And on, when you look at the figures, the coverage is very, very good. But the problem is it always seems to be the low-lying fruit that's taken, the easy to get to areas. So I have a situation where it's actually new estates that don't have, we have an option in our area for cable and fibre optic broadband. The fibre optics is the only one available, and most of the complaints come from new areas. Is there anything you can do to encourage the planning system, local authorities, to ensure that when new estates are going up, that there is those coverages?
Yeah, so we are, although it's not in our direct gift, we certainly are involved in conversations. So, for example, the question about new build that you have is actually a broader issue. Similarly, we've had issues of business parks, paradoxically. So business parks, which in the past have been bypassed for fibre optic cable. So certainly in the discussions that I have with operators, but also in the discussions which are now being convened by the Westminster politicians. So there's a digital infrastructure task force, which is looking very actively at these issues, and I sit on it. And so we are... we are working behind the scenes, but also in the strategic review we will talk about how universality, you can't just write it down on a piece of paper. There are a whole series of very practical steps that need to be taken, and that's why for us the first step of making visible where the gaps are, we feel, is really vital, so we've at least all got the same data to work from.
I suppose it's a bit of chicken and egg. In rural areas particularly, and you'll know the Highlands and Islands is an area, you know, larger than Belgium, with the population of Brussels is the little shorthand that we occasionally use, is about, I suppose from the market point of view, there's probably a lack of demand. But secondly, there's also a lack of operators to actually run that. And that probably leads me nicely on to the calls for BT to sell off Openreach. You touched on this in your opening statement, and you did explain, I think, there was four different options. I mean, how likely is this to happen? Would this help the market? Would this help us provide more competition, provide more operators to provide better standards of broadband?
Yeah, I mean, you'll appreciate that given we haven't quite concluded, I'm slightly limited this morning, but what I would say is that in looking at the open reach question, we will be looking at it not from a, you know, different models of governance as a sort of academic question. We will be looking at it from the point of view is, will a different structure encourage more investment? Will it encourage better quality of service? So those will be the sort of metrics and the criteria that we will be approaching. As you say, there are going to be some areas of the country where, with the best will in the world, you know, one's top priority is just to get access. Mm. And so, you know, the likelihood of having, you know, a competitive number of rivals, you know, in Orkney and the Shetland Islands, the commercials aren't necessarily there. But I think there is an interesting question about whether we can get some competition in terms of their technology. So at least you're not necessarily reliant on a fixed line connection, but you've got wireless operators who might be able to come in too. So although I'm afraid I'm sort of unable to say more definitively where we're coming out on Openreach, I hope give some assurance to the committee. We will be judging that question from the perspective of, are we going to get more investment? Is the rollout going to be faster? Mm. Are we going to get better quality of service from a different model?
My final question, Convener, is, you know, my contention is that broadband development is probably one of the most vital ways of increasing economic activity in the Highlands and Islands, and indeed across the UK, and particularly in rural areas. And you'll know that some of the technical solutions aren't just about fibre optic, because it'll go in very hard to reach it communities. It'll require satellite development to have broadband, Wi-Fi, and indeed 4G, but of course there's problems with 4G as well. Can you give any comfort to committee about the developments in some of these technical solutions? Is that a role that Ofgem have as well, over the technical provision of broadband?
Yeah, so we're in a very similar similar place to you, that we would love there to be, particularly when we think about the implementation of the USO, that we do that through a variety of technologies. And we do it through a variety of technologies, partly, as you say, because fixed lines are not necessarily going to be the best solution for very remote communities, but also from our perspective, we want there to be choice and we want there to be more competition in the way in which further access is rolled out.
I did say final, but I think I'm in a senior moment. I forgot the other question I was going to raise. Yeah, I keep going. One of the things I'm quite interested in as well is where government has a role, for example, in the world of contracts, that, you know, Wi-Fi, broadband is seen as a function. So, for example, in some of our ferry services, consumers, if I give you a classic example, the Calmac ferries to Clyde Hebridean. I was involved in a previous role chairing the petitions committee when school children in Harris were very, very keen that there was Wi-Fi provision, and in fairness, the company picked this up, and this is now going to be developed. So in future tenders, this will be a condition. You have to provide it. You'll be aware, of course, this is a condition in tenders for the East Coast London services, and increasingly for ScotRail, which is clearly within Scotland. I mean, I think this is another way that government can lead by making this a minimum service condition. What's your view on that?
I mean, I agree. I think, you know, given the priority to ensure that broadband, whether you are travelling by car or by rail, whether you're going about your daily life and you need mobility of connectivity, I think we're very, very strongly supportive of finding, I mean, I know the government, you know, is looking at for the south of the border rail franchising, for example, whether there are ways in which one can apply conditions on greater connectivity there, following very, you know, very similar lines, the example you gave. I think all of this needs to be all of this needs to be on the table, and we're very strongly supportive. We will come in advising on some of the technical details and some of the technological solutions, but we've got exactly the same objective, which is, you know, over the next period, we have got good connections everywhere.
Right. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Perhaps I could ask you about the two voluntary codes that which applies to business broadband speeds and residential broadband speeds. Can you tell us how that is proceeding? Is it proceeding well? Are you getting the buy-in from the internet service providers?
Yes, thank you. So the
data and information that will be available as a result of that, and will that provide consumers and businesses with information which allows them to see how the company is performing and what particular service individual businesses and consumers are receiving from them?
So it's early days. I think the committee will know that last summer we published a voluntary code whereby all the big internet service providers, so BT's in there, Virgin's in there, a number of other companies are in there, so that if a residential consumer feels that the service that they signed onto is not the service that they have got, actually the companies have committed to make it easier for consumers to walk away without a fixed penalty. And we've done something very similar in the last couple of weeks for small businesses. So it's quite early, but I think again it ties to the point that even the point in urban areas that you think you'll often consumers think they're signing on to an up to of 10 megabits per second or 20 megabits per second, and the service they have coming through may be appreciably low for a variety of reasons. What the code does is that the providers have committed to be much more transparent and much clearer at the point of sale, and then if things do go wrong, you know, the customer's not then in an argument about, you know, having to pay some sort of early termination fee. It's too early for us to have data, but certainly, you know, I think it will give us good evidence over the coming months as to whether actually the code has had to be almost invoked, or whether actually the fact that we now have a voluntary agreement means that the point of sale itself is becoming a more robust process.
Okay, and are there any other outcomes that you would expect as a result of the introduction of these codes?
I hope that it also means that consumers shop around a bit more, and I know that's obviously practically hindered where you don't have a choice of providers, but even between as you say cable and BT, actually just having that point of sale where you've got a couple of providers clear about what they're providing. And you're not just looking through a sort of 20-page contract of small print and ticking the terms of condition and, you know, jumping out of the shop as quickly as you can. I do hope it means that consumers are able to exert, where there is competition, just more pressure at the point of sale.
Okay, thank you. And you mentioned earlier the issue of BT and Openreach, and the option of separating out Openreach from the broader BT group is something that was being looked at. Can you just tell us a little bit more about that process, what the timescales for it are, and how will you go about evaluating the advantages and disadvantages of each of the four options, including the status quo that you referred to earlier?
Happily, so we launched the review of the communications market last March, and we published in July what we called a discussion paper, which essentially set out the half a dozen or so areas that we were keen to look at, which I've run through: deregulation, quality of service, and so on, including on the Openreach question. And we set out at that stage our sort of preliminary view of what the issues were, what we felt had worked well over the last 10 years, and perhaps what had worked less well. And then we used the discussion document as a call for evidence. And so subsequent to July, so between July and October, we've had a number of encyclopedias of evidence that have been received, mostly from the companies, but from broader stakeholders too. And we've had, as an organisation, we've had lots and lots of meetings too to follow those up. So we've taken in evidence between July and October, and then subsequent to October, we have been evaluating the evidence, checking against the issues that we flagged in July to see where we hadn't got things right, where we need to sort of modify where we haven't attached the right priority in some areas, and then we are hoping with a fair wind to set out initial conclusions at the end of this month.
Okay, and a final outcome to this process will be when? And the final announcement when?
Yeah, so the initial conclusions at the end of this month will set out the results of our deliberations. You may know that in applying those directions or recommendations to our practical regulatory tools, there is a process that we follow through Europe. So we will be reviewing, as Europe requests us to, every 3 years, each individual market. So for example, say we recommend that we will deregulate in a particular area. When the market review for that area comes up, we will take those initial conclusions from the end of February and then start to apply that in detail to our regulatory tools. So it will be the sort of implementation process will be a period of, you know, several years from now.
Okay, can I just ask you finally, you know, irrespective of which of the four options you finally go with, what are you actually looking for in terms of how Openreach can better serve Scotland's broadband infrastructure needs?
So, as I say, the starting point is how can consumers up and down the country get the service that they deserve, with consumer expectations rising by the day. And so we will certainly be looking at the issues of quality of service, actually irrespective of any discussions about the structure of Openreach. So the committee may be aware that a couple of years ago we had got, indeed, you know, to BT's credit, I think they were equally concerned, but we were very, very concerned, particularly about the quality of service issues on the business side. So this is particularly if you're actually a big business and you are having a bespoke super fast cables installed, which means construction in the streets and cables up your building. It was just long delays of several months. And it's the first time that we dipped our toe in the water as a regulator to set minimum quality standards for BT, which one feels quite conflicted about, to be honest, as a regulator, because we're an outside body. And for an outside body to be setting the standards for a company that operates across the UK is a slightly sort of second best situation. But we will be looking at the experience of the impact of those quality of service standards, which to BT's credit they have hit subsequently, and whether that goes forward, whether we strengthen, whether we set different tougher targets, that's all for consideration.
Okay, thank you. Alex, you have some questions.
Yes, we're on the competition issue, and one of the concerns that has been expressed is that BT are squeezing the margin between wholesale and retail prices in order to effectively squeeze out competition in areas where they've got a near monopoly. Does Ofcom still have concerns about the wholesale price of Superfast broadband?
So you probably know that that's a regulated price. Mm-hmm. So we have something called in the technical jargon, it's a VULA margin. So we require BT to ensure that there is a big enough gap between its wholesale and retail price to allow other companies to come in and still to make a profit. And we do that because obviously if you're BT, you've got a lot of costs, you know, you've already got an existing network, you come in with a historic cost advantage, and so we have set a margin to allow, you know, companies like TalkTalk or Sky to come in. So that is a regulated price. It has to be said, we're currently in litigation, so it's being contested as we speak by BT, but at the moment we do set that in a regulated way to ensure that competitors aren't squeezed out because of BT's historic cost advantage.
As you said, BT are contesting that. If, you know, without speculating about what the outcome of that might be, do you have any alternative plans to or alternative approaches to ensuring that remains an area where competition is viable?
I guess what I can say very strongly is we are absolutely committed to ensuring that consumers, where there is a market, get a choice of provider. And so, I mean, I can't speculate on whether the VULA margin is going to be struck down or not. If it is, or if it's modified, then we will clearly have to look at alternatives, but with the objective in mind of ensuring that there remains competition.
In the broader sense, from the consumer point of view, what's Ofcom doing to help consumers and businesses make informed decisions about the best telecommunications deals available?
Yeah. So the I think this issue of pricing is really interesting, and an area that we are wanting to do more on. And it's an area that we want to do more on because the market itself is becoming more complex. I mean, as you know, people are increasingly moving to what are called triple play bundles. So we are, you know, we're buying our telly and our phone line and our broadband together. And it's possible that with the BTEE merger, we may move, like the rest of the continent, to quad play. It just becomes much more complicated for people to compare deals when you've got headline prices and discounts and so on. And so a couple of things. We've been, firstly, very supportive of the Advertising Standards Authority, who are trying now to get better transparency in pricing. So I think one of the issues you may have picked up as a committee is that you sometimes get these sort of very, very big font headline deals of, you know, super fast broadband free, and then in rather smaller font, and by the way, you're still paying your £16 monthly landline charge. So we've been very keen to get more transparency at the point of sale. We are also now starting to collect much more pricing data, because one of the things we have started to find, and again, the committee's probably aware of this, is that although the market is still in aggregate very competitive, some prices have started to rise, particularly landline prices, and particularly for customers who tend to be the over 75s, tend to be more vulnerable groups who don't switch providers. So we are, again, actually as part of the communications review, we'll be looking at options for greater transparency of pricing information, while trying to, you know, and there's a careful balance to tread, because in making prices more transparent, you don't want to standardise the tariffs, because actually that takes competition out. But we do want to find better ways by which people can compare what is an increasingly bundled and increasingly complicated market.
Of course, where competition exists, the ease of switching provider is often a big challenge and a barrier in some cases. What's Ofcom doing to make it easier for people to switch provider?
Yeah, so at the moment, we are particularly looking at trying to make the process of switching easier. And so last summer, after a lot of work by the teams, it's now much easier if you're with a provider that's on the Open Reach network. So if you're with, you know, if you're with BT or with Sky or TalkTalk, etc., all you now need to do is to ring up the company that you're trying to move to, and they will, in one, what we call sort of one touch, but in one move, basically make the switch for you. We are now looking to do something similar for mobile, where we've done some research which suggests, you know, you've got the pack code that you need to ring up one company and get it to switch to another company. We're trying to make that process a little bit easier. And then we've said that we will then look at triple play. I think there is to my mind, there's actually a broader question, which comes back actually to your point about pricing and complexity. You know, we're all pretty inert. And, you know, not many of us have got, you know, time to spend on a call centre call to switch. And so although we are looking at making the process easier, I am quite interested over the longer term at looking whether there are other ways that one can encourage consumers to switch. Because even if you've got a faster process, unless your service is really, really poor, most of us kind of stick with the people that we know. And in a situation where companies are starting to consolidate, I do think personally that I think as Ofcom, we need to look at the whole process of switching and how consumers actually switch, how you can encourage consumers to be less inert. And some of the other regulators, I think, have probably taken, you know, some quite innovative ways on this. I think this is a really, really critical area, because as soon as you move to bundled products, people stop switching. I think the rate of switching, if you've got triple play, is about 7%. Because it's just, you know, you'll lose everything. Why would you switch? Mm-hmm. So it's a critical issue. We're doing some We're making some progress, but I think it's a broader part of a broader piece we now need to look at.
Just as a, for my information, where deals have been offered that cover broadband, landlines, mobiles, perhaps television supply, does that play a major part in excluding companies that cannot compete at that highest level?
So this, I think this is a really interesting question, and I think it plays to the sorts of changes in market structure we're seeing at the moment. So if we were sitting in Europe, actually quad play, mobile, landline, broadband, TV is a much more typical way of selling. And so I think, you know, we've now seen BT becoming a television company. We've seen BT now going back to mobile that it had with Cellnet. You've got the proposed merger between O2 and 3 on the mobile company. You've got Sky has said that it's going to do a tie-up deal with O2 later this year. And I think you can see companies started to converge. The telcos looking more like TV companies, the TV companies needing to get into the broadband, and particularly because mobile has become the, you know, such a device of viewing and seeing programs. I think it's absolutely true that we will see growing convergence, and possibly us catching up with the continent that we buy more of our services in a four package bundle.
Thank you.
Clear.
Thank you, convener. I was very interested in what you were saying about consumer information and choice at the point in which they're looking at it, and particularly the postcode areas that you were talking about. But Ofcom had a map that showed the fixed broadband information by administrative authority, but it hasn't been updated since 2013. Is that you're about to do? Fantastic.
So the date has been shifted between, exactly. I think it's now March. What we're trying to do is now pull together the mobile data that we have updated. Can you make a phone call on a smartphone, and bring that together with updated fixed data? And then we're trying to splice those two things together, ultimately by household. That's the plan over the course of this year, but we will get the fixed line data out very shortly.
Okay, excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Michael.
Thank you, convener. I was pleased to hear you mentioning the Highlands and Islands in your opening statement, because Dave and I both represent the Highlands and Islands, and I'm not sure that Dave fully articulated the scale of the problem. When you go to the Highlands and Islands, if you were to draw a map, despite the theoretical coverage, I think it's the equivalent of the medieval map that said, here there'd be dragons. when you disappear over the digital divide, my PA says that, you know, I know you're about to go dark. I think she watches too many spy thrillers. but, you know, that is the reality. And in talking to colleagues of yours over many years now, I've been constantly reassured that things are just about to get better. But the reality is that things aren't getting better. They're getting worse. That digital divide is like the Grand Canyon, but it's getting deeper and it's getting wider. And part of the reason for that seems to be that there's more demand, more people are using the services, digital services, and part of it seems to be the content, the services that are available. So, you know, what used to be a simple newspaper website now has got all kinds of theatrical stuff going on. It's got embedded films and so on. No doubt shortly we'll be having, you know, avatars popping out your phone and dancing across the table. And that's driven by, you know, good, you know, availability of, service provision elsewhere in the country. And the contrast, therefore, is getting wider and wider between, you know, the services that my constituents get. And so, given that, you know, part of the reason you're here, I think part of the game changer here, if I understand it, is this new Scottish board member. You know, is that really going to be a game changer? Or you know, and can I go back and look my constituents in the eye and say to them with integrity, things are going to get better, not worse in real terms over the coming years.
Yeah, so I think what you can say is that, you know, the picture that you just painted, not only do I completely recognise, but it's at the top of the intro for us. And I think this point about consumer expectations are in a completely different place. As I say, even 2, 3, 4, 5 years. And it's, you know, it's not just your dancing avatars. It's the fact that will we be able to get through to the NHS actually on our medical records, or figure out where our kids are going to school, or set up a business without having to leave the Highlands and Islands and head off to Glasgow. It's fundamental, and that's why I think the conversation about utilities or human rights is absolutely at the core. Now, I think the Scottish board member is important. I do, as my own, just in terms of, you know, just my character, if there's a problem, I need to figure out how we're going to fix it. I think the key thing for me is how the universal service obligation gets implemented for the Highlands and Islands. That, for me, is the test case. Because for all the reasons you say about geography, you know, costs of, you know, getting backhaul out, all the rest of, you know, and then the question about, you know, choice of technologies and how wireless technology is going to work for this, and to do it in a way that by the time the Highlands and Islands has got coverage, we're not finding actually that 40 megabits per second has become the new 10. So there is that trick of, for me, of putting in the foundation stone, but in a way that allows the gearing up as consumer expectations, you know, our desire to do stuff without necessarily having to, you know, take a car or take a train. It's really, really important. And that's why, for me, it's partly the Scottish board members, also, to be frank, about how my colleagues, how I as chief executive, my understanding as we take forward the USO, which we expect to be implementing once the government has set out the policy parameters, when I ask my teams the question, okay, what does this mean for connectivity, not in Aberdeen, what does this mean for connectivity in the Highlands and Islands, over what time scale, what's the rollout, okay, clearly there'll be a cost premium, how is that going to be actually as a matter of practicality then shared, provided for, is it the user, individual user, or is that shared across a broader community, given in a sense we all benefit? That's the test for me. So governance matters, but the test for me is universality for a regulator that has the consumer first is a top priority.
Okay, thank you. And could you give us a view on what coverage then of 3G and 4G will look like in Scotland over the maybe a time frame of the next year?
Yeah, and actually the next year is really critical. I mean, partly at the moment, as you know, there's a lot of market structure change or proposed change amongst the mobile network operators, but there is the commitment there to coverage by 2017. And so one of the things we will be doing, partly through making more visible who is providing what services and where in Scotland, we will be working with, I'm sure it will be a constructive engagement with the mobile network operators to see where they are in terms of meeting their, you know, 95 and 90% coverage obligations, both on geography and on premises over the next, as I say, it's the next year. I can't quite believe I'm in 2016 already, but it's coming very close.
Dave Stewart touched on this, the idea that, you know, in some areas, to be fair, Inverness, which is the city within the Highlands and Islands, is, you know, gets reasonable 4G coverage and so on. But an awful lot of my constituents, and I think this is where we have to be careful, we'll talk about 10 megabytes being, you know, unacceptable. But a very high proportion of my constituents would die for 10 megabits. It's maybe closer to 2, sometimes 500 kilobytes. It's, you know, really very, very poor, to the point where it's almost not worth having. And, you know, and it's the same when we talk about 90% coverage. It's always the same 10% who are continually left out. Now, I think we all understand why that is. It's, you might describe it as market failure, but surely it's a definition of regulatory failure, the missing 10%, and that are there any plans within that, you know, to address that missing 10%?
So, I mean, you'll know that, you know, the government's initiative here to try to fill the rest of the gap that the commercial providers hadn't set out in their coverage obligations, the MIPS, or the, you know, the mobile infrastructure project has had a difficult history in Scotland. I think in this case one looks to the regulator, but one also looks to the regulator working with the companies and working with the government. So, for example, there are plans on the emergency services front, which, you know, is going to be a sort of mobile infrastructure, will be UK-wide. Personally, I think there's a really interesting opportunity to use that rollout actually to get broader coverage, so not just your ability to make a 999 phone call on your mobile, but actually to get broader coverage. And that's, again, as part of this digital infrastructure task force, this is the conversation that we are keen to have. To give you assurance, you know, this stuff is hard to deliver, but I start at the 100%, not the 90%. And actually, if you look at 10 megabits per second, 40% of the UK doesn't get 10 megabits today. So we are talking about a very, very, very differentiated story, mostly because of rurality.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Neill. Thank you. Both Mike McKenzie and Dave Stewart have articulated the challenges in terms of the digital divide in rural and remote parts of Scotland. I wonder if you could address specifically the issues in terms of digital exclusion that face people on low incomes, people in receipt of benefits, and how you, as a regulator, seek to address those.
So, I mean, this is, it's partly why we have been very focused about issues of pricing. So, I guess for us as a regulator, not as government, our particular focus is to try where we can to maximise as much competition. Now, as I say, I know that has got limits in Scotland, because where that's commercial is relatively limited. But for us, the key way in which we have observed that we will get prices down and prices most affordable is through having rival players who are competing for business. Now, the question about what happens with pricing where you're in a rural area, I mean, that's in a sense where it comes to where we regulate pricing. So where you've got BT as a dominant player, we do, as a regulator, have tools to apply what we call charge controls to make sure both that the prices that BT then charges to other wholesale operators or potentially directly to consumers, the advantage isn't taken of their dominant power in the market. And we apply, I think, 90% of BT's BT Openreach's prices are regulated by us directly.
I mean, you said earlier that, you know, this is the fourth utility. And, of course, in other utilities, particularly in the area of energy, companies will seek to provide a different tariff for people who are in receipt of benefits. So, you know, what's the equivalent within this sector?
And there are some equivalents. So we talked a bit about landline, which is, from everything we know, it's the area which has got the greatest reliance by the most vulnerable people, by the most vulnerable consumers. And there, BT and others do have sort of basic tariffs which try to ensure that that vulnerable people aren't, you know, essentially are able to get a decent service, even if they're on a fixed or unstable income. This is an area that more generally I want to look at over the next period, because of the concern, not yet realised, but the concern as to whether consolidation in the sector may have an impact on pricing, and what that does, not just for people who are able to pay, but what that does particularly for people on low and fixed incomes. Whether that's then for the regulator to come in, or whether that's a public policy intervention, I think that's a different question.
But are you, as the regulator, doing enough, and what more can you do?
As I say, I think, you can always argue whether you're doing doing enough. I do think that we're at a potential turning point in the market, is what I would say, is because if you look over the last 10 years, and this is an aggregate, so I do take the point about, you know, the people at the end, but as an aggregate, we have been paying about the same for a much broader set of services. And that's because the sort of technology and so on has meant that, particularly on the mobile side, we basically have been getting more for less. We are in a situation where companies are converging. We are in a situation where companies are wanting to consolidate. And certainly the evidence that we see from other countries is that that can have a material impact on pricing, particularly when you get what we call the horizontal merger, so a mobile company buying another mobile company. That's why we are now starting to do much more detailed analysis of pricing. If pricing does appear to be, if there does appear to be a regulatory problem there, then we will act.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm going to pass to Adam, who has a final question.
Okay, thanks, convener. I'd like to change the subject a little bit. You'd mentioned earlier on in your remarks that you see a switch from landlines to mobiles. And I certainly have also noticed a change in how landlines are used. A lot of calls are going straight to voicemail. And to my mind, a lot of that is created by nuisance, what we can call nuisance calling, more like harassment in many cases. The constant calls that we get from PPI or seeking boiler replacements or computer-generated calls or calls from foreign call centres coming in. So people are stopping using their landline as they used to do. Do you think this is a problem, particularly for people who are perhaps vulnerable? And secondly, what are you going to do about it?
I mean, the issue of nuisance calls is incredibly important. I talked about my mailbag. And, you know, where I'm not getting complaints about quality of service, the rest is almost entirely nuisance calls. And as you say, it's not just frustrating, but particularly for vulnerable people, this can be incredibly distressing. I would say, as an aside, I think part of the shift from landline to mobile is also just the smartphone. So actually, we can just do more stuff with the mobile. We are working very closely with the Information Commissioner on nuisance calls. We have a sort of very particular division of labour in that Ofcom, we have statutory responsibilities for silent and abandoned calls, and the Information Commissioner has got responsibility for also classic PPI mis-selling. But we are working actually in a very coordinated way. Both we and the ICO now come under the Department for Culture and Media Sports, which I think has also helped. And as a matter of practicality, we have been looking, particularly my technical experts, working with the communication providers and the ICO to try to get more technical fixes on this. And, you know, fingers crossed, we think we're making quite a lot of progress. As you know, lots of these calls originate overseas. Lots of these calls aren't necessarily wrong numbers, but they mask the number with a real number, and they bounce around various points of contact before they come to the user. We think we may have a technical fix that could have quite a significant impact on the number of calls that are coming through, and I hope shortly we'll be able to say some more publicly. But it is absolutely a critical issue.
I take your point about technical solutions, but technical solutions tend to eventually... people tend to get round them. Yes. So is there not a case for some stronger legislation on this area?
I mean, it's interesting. You'll probably know that in the last session there was more, the government took stronger powers in the area of nuisance calls. And partly on the back of that, the Information Commissioner is now taking much tougher enforcement and certainly issuing higher fines. So when I say technical fixes, I don't want to give the sense that I'm being naive, that somehow, you squeeze one bit of the balloon and guess what, it bursts somewhere else. But at the same time, what's been interesting, you know, I have lots of very difficult conversations with a number of the companies we regulate. Nuisance calls is the area where there is probably the strongest, clearest consensus that something needs to be done. So I think the technical side is important. I don't think by any means it's part of the picture. It's the whole part of the picture. I'm not sure whether the government, having already taken new powers for the Information Commissioner, will want to step forward with new statutory obligations. I personally would be very interested if the committee has got ideas for what more could be done. We can certainly take that away. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Yeah, it's an idea, I hope. It's just obviously one of the ways to limit, not stop, the nuisance calls is for consumers to be able to not accept anonymous numbers. But a lot of the service providers have a charge for that service. Is there anything you can do to encourage them to provide that as a free service to customers?
We'll definitely take that away. I mean, you'll know we have been doing some work with some of the premium numbers, and we introduced some changes last summer, which we're reviewing to see actually whether transparency is leading to prices falling or not. But I would certainly take that away. Thank you.
Dave.
Can I ask a technical question on the back of that? A number of constituents have written to me, obviously, about nuisance calls. They're part of the preference service. So my understanding about that is that you would opt into that and you shouldn't get these calls. And what the response has been from some companies, oh, we're exempt because we're a marketing company. I don't know if you've come across that solution. Is that an exemption to the preference service?
So one of the things that does happen with the TPS is that you might be buying something on the internet and you accidentally tick the box. You think you're ticking the box which says, oh my goodness, I don't want any marketing, and actually you've ticked the box which says, I do want marketing. Or if you essentially sign in inadvertently or not to marketing, then you are still going to get calls. And that's one of the issues that, again, I think we need to make clearer to consumers. So I think when they say that marketing companies are exempt, what I think they mean is that consumers, they will have a form, a piece of paper or an email which says, yes, I've bought some theatre tickets and I'm very happy to hear about, you know, a whole bunch of other things which I didn't think I'd signed up to.
So constituents should be clearer when they're signing up to things to watch that. So is the solution then to go back and re-sign up to the preference service? Or does that not make any difference?
So because I dug around at this as well, because I was surprised when I came into this job that the TPS, I wouldn't say has a hole in it, but it was new to me that the very fact that you have said, I am happy, and it can be, you know, it's often quite small font, but I am happy to receive marketing material, means that the company has taken that you're happy to receive marketing material. So I do think it's a bit of a message to consumers, but I think it's also greater clarity about what the TPS can and can't do.
So if you're a company that breaches the preference service, apart from the issue you've just raised, I mean, what are the sanctions, and do you have a role in, you presumably have a role in regulating this?
So if you've got constituents who have got, who have signed up to the TPS, and are still being bombarded with calls, they should get in touch either with Ofcom and or the Information Commissioner's Office.
Would that be a role for your new Scottish representative?
Yeah, they can take some of my letters.
Right.
Okay, do members have any further questions? Are there any final comments that you would like to place on the record, Ms White?
I just say thank you. This has been a huge pleasure. Thank you very much indeed.
Well, I think the feeling is mutual. I think we've found that a very useful session, and we very much welcome your attendance at today's session and your positive and constructive engagement with the committee. We'll certainly, as a committee, be keeping a close eye on developments, the strategic review of digital communications being foremost among them, but also what difference the new Ofcom board member for Scotland will make, and the voluntary codes of practice for business and residential broadband speeds is another development that we will be keeping a close eye on, and also the review of Openreach's provision of superfast broadband. So clearly there's a huge agenda of relevance to this committee and to the people of Scotland, and we very much welcome your engagement with the committee. We hope that this will not be your last session in front of
the
committee.
Might be back. Thank you, convener. Thank you, all members.
You can be assured of that. Thank you very much. We now suspend this meeting briefly for a witness handover. morning. We now resume this meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Agenda item 2 is for the committee to continue its inquiry into the circumstances surrounding the closure of the fourth road bridge. And this morning we will hear from independent bridge experts. I welcome John Evans, consultant at Flint and Neill, Richard Fish, independent engineering consultant, and Peter Hill, general manager and Bridgemaster at the Humber Bridge Board. Good morning, gentlemen. I intend to move straight on to questions for this session. I'm going to ask Alec Johnson to kick off our questions this morning.
Thank you very much, convener. Now, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I understand we have expertise on the panel that include the Humber, the Tamar and the Severn Bridge. Would that be right? We have heard from experts who took evidence from previously that rather than follow the Department of Transport recommendations, on the fourth bridge there was an approach to inspections that was risk-based and often resulted in the frequency of inspections being higher than would have been recommended. Can you explain to us what the frequency of inspections at the Humber, Tamar and Severn bridges were and whether you also adopt that risk-based approach?
Can I kick off, please, convener? I believe it's correct to say that the first very formal attempt at this risk-based approach was done on the Severn Bridge. And in my opinion, the reason for it was largely commercial rather than purely engineering, because the Severn Bridge was going to become part of the concession agreement for the construction of the second crossing, and the operation and maintenance of both bridges throughout the concession period. And you can imagine that the concessionaires were very interested in knowing, among other things, what kind of monies and resource they would have to expend on inspecting and maintaining both their new bridge, which was really under their control, but also the 40-year-old bridge by that time that they were taking over to run as well. Now, as to timing, this came at the end of a series of contracts for strengthening and uprating the Severn anyway, and that was undertaken by our firm on behalf of the Department of Transport, originally Highways Agency, and for this reason we were deemed to know as much about the structure as probably anybody. And it was part of my individual personal duty to develop this maintenance manual for the Severn Bridge, which became volume 12, I think it was, of the concession agreement. So it was very much a contractual document. And to go back to your question, the concept of vulnerability and criticality was built into that inspection regime. And there were a number of different periods of inspection allocated to different elements of the structure. They were based largely on the engineering, in other words, what the structure was going to suffer from the point of view of stressing and straining and movement and so on. But they were also based on the experience of operating the bridge up to that point. And I think, have I answered your question sufficiently?
I think we've got to that answer.
Can I extend with regards to the matters at the Humber? And certainly commercial aspects do play a part, but there's also the practicalities of such huge structures, and the risk-based approach makes it practical to ensure that we do have a sustainable system for inspection that doesn't overload the organisation with either providing unnecessary resources or unnecessary data in some respects. The standard format for inspection, as the committee may be aware, is for 2 yearly general inspections and 6 yearly principal inspections, which were set by the Department for Transport. Of course, these are generally for owners of a large stock of bridges. We are owners of a large bridge at the Humber, not a large stock of bridges. And therefore, we also found a risk-based approach was most appropriate, both looking at the risk of failure of any element and the consequences of failure of that element. Certain areas such as the abutments, which take the load from the cables ultimately at either end, they are big blocks of concrete. And in 10 years' time, they'll still be big blocks of concrete. So an intensive inspection of those is perhaps not practical or sensible. Whereas other more flexible elements on the bridge require greater monitoring and more frequent inspection. So we have also adopted a risk-based approach.
Thank you. For the record, I'm no longer have direct responsibility for Tamar Bridge. That sadly ended in about 2008 when I left public sector and moved into the private sector. But since that time, I've developed my own business in a sense around bridge management and bridge maintenance. So I can link perhaps a question and the answer to the question both from Tamar experience and more recent. And I think from in the old days of the Tamar Bridge, it was exactly as Peter has described about the frequency of 2 year general, 6 year principal. And it was at the time of the changes around the UK Bridges Board developing a code of practice for highway structures, which first introduced this concept of risk-based inspections. And certainly Tamar has, in the interim, moved towards risk-based. Because I think it's important that inspection should not just be prescriptive. The risk is you just end up ticking a load of boxes. What bits have I got to look at today? Yes, I've looked at that, I've looked at this, tick, tick. You've got to be a bit more reactive to what the bridge's behaviour is, how it's performing. And if there are areas of concern, little hotspots which you think, well, actually, we need to look a lot more detail at this, then you would, by instinct, want to increase that inspection frequency. But at the same time, it's got to be recorded and regulated. So that's the shift to risk-based. You're developing an idea that says, as Peter has described, some areas of the structures are not going to change over decades. Others may change over months and years. So that's where you target your inspections. And that's a more efficient and, dare I say, safe way of approaching it.
Mr. Fish, can you just explain for the lay people, both in this room and outside, who are watching our proceedings, what the difference is between the general and principal inspections?
Certainly, yes. It's a general, as you might suggest, is... I hesitate to use the word superficial, but you only have to look at elements of the structure from a distance. And if you can get up close, all very good. The big issue around principal inspections, so actually two issues. One is that they should be carried out by a chartered civil or structural engineer. And secondly, that every part of the bridge should be accessed within touching distance.
Helpful, thank you.
Big bridges, even if they're of similar design, are unique structures. We are focusing in on the truss end links, which have been exposed as the weak link in this case. I presume that each of the bridges we've talked about and your general experience covers components that are similar to the truss end link, would that be?
I think Tamar is the closest in that... The similarity between Tamar and Forth are that they both have stiffening trusses, whereas Severn and Humber are aerofoil box sections, so it's a slightly different arrangement. But Tamar is very similar to Forth in that end of the trusses where they arrive at the tower, there are the vertical connections, pintles with the pins, which do the same job as at Forth.
Taking the risk-based approach, how often would you expect critical components of the bridge to be inspected, and how often you would you inspect a component such as a truss end link?
Shall I just go first rather than hog it? But as a general statement, I think those connections and the pintles are perhaps the most overlooked part of a traditional truss type suspension bridge. Everyone focuses on cables and hangers and towers and the steelwork of the trusses. They do tend to get overlooked. That's not to say they're not inspected, and I know at Tamar I've personally gone down and accessed them and checked for movement, but it is a very difficult thing to inspect, especially because it's actually, you're relying on the movement for the articulation of the bridge. But I'm sure at Tamar, and I spoke to the bridge manager the other day, and he said as soon as the news of Forth came out, that was the first thing he went to look at, was the pintles on Tamar.
And say at the Humber, we do have elements that move in the same way. They're not truss end links, but they are structural elements that rotate on a bearing point. And it's actually something that we have very recently replaced. Because these were inspected and found to have failed. But the mechanism of failure was actually by excessive wear, which becomes quite apparent over time. So even a general inspection or a superficial inspection, which is even more of a walk past, could identify, in the case of the Humber, that type of failure. It wouldn't identify if an element was seized. With our pins, the bearings had actually formed an oval rather than a circle for the pin to move in due to wear. So it did become visually apparent, and that's perhaps the difference. And I'm talking about the Humber, but it's coincidental that I was actually talking myself to the manager of the Tamar yesterday. We actually had one of our annual meetings of bridge managers. And they do have a similar issue with similar elements at the Tamar. But again, it's being observed through wear.
Is that right?
Oh, sorry.
May I? Seven is slightly different again. During the assessment for the new loadings, it was discovered that the original, we call them props, end props, because they're much shorter with a shallower box. But the original ones from the 1960s design were overloaded for the new system. So part of the strengthening was to replace those completely. And they were replaced by bigger ones, more outboard. And as part of the replacement process, we refurbished the inner ones and provided them with a jacking facility so that in a planned operation we could come back and jack again and inspect the outer ones more carefully, more we could check the loads as well as looking visually. And for this reason, by 1990, the equivalent system on 7 had been completely renovated. But the original problem was twofold. It was overloaded, and there was wear.
So there was wear rather than seizing.
Yes.
Is there any, or are you aware of any examples of a similar mechanism seizing at any other bridge?
We did have a little talk just before we came here, and I think that the closest that I can identify were some bridges in America which had a suspended middle span, mm-hmm. and those hung on links. And I believe that there were problems with those. There was one actual catastrophic collapse, but these were a family of bridges on the interstate, and they were all refurbished. It's possible that the one on the M50 was not dissimilar, but I've never worked on that one, so I don't know.
Mm. Yep. Do you know of any bridges which adopt special inspection or monitoring techniques to check whether the pins are moving correctly? And if so, what would these methods be?
Shall I go again? I think I don't know of any system that checks whether the pins are moving. There are systems that check the movement of the bridge, so it's the whole link. And the forces involved, as I think Richard Hornby told you, are enormous. So you're more likely to damage something if there's a jam pin. But I don't know of anything that actually checks whether the pins are turning. And as I think the committee has already discovered, you can't see these pins where they turn.
Is it an easy thing to check? Because just from my own imagining of how the situation would be, while flexibility is essential in this element, the actual level of movement must be extremely small.
Well, the movement will be small in terms of the rotation on the pin. But if that's not, if that movement isn't taking place, the structure will still move. So there would be some, and as the structure moves, strains develop, and hence the material becomes stressed and potentially overstressed against its original design loads. I would just echo John's point, really, in that I'm not aware of anything which would specifically be able to detect movement.
But in normal weather conditions, if you stood beside that pin and looked at it, there would not normally be very much movement.
I think to visually discern that movement would be very difficult. What may well come out of all of this is actually something which is devised by people who look at structural health monitoring, etc., to actually come up with a concept which actually will help detect movement or lack of it. But it's not something you want to sit in front of that pin for hours on a time, trying to just see if it's moving. Some sort of remote sensing, I'm sure, can be developed. But at the moment, structural health monitoring, or as I like to think of it, structural performance monitoring, is more geared to the performance of the whole structure. How's it working? How's it articulating? What's the deflections compared to the loads, etc.? So you'll get a picture of everything that's going on, but actually diagnosing a particular small issue can't be done with a more global structural performance system.
Yes. Thank you.
If I could just add a little bit to that, because as I think has been discussed around the movements of elements of the structure away from the actual pin bearing, that may be in the order of tens of millimetres, once they are transferred back to the actual pin mechanism, are remarkably small, extremely small movements. But in absence of that movement, the forces transmitted can be very large.
Yes.
The one thing we did do at the Humber with our replacement system was to install a system monitoring the stresses in adjacent materials. Not the pin bearing itself, but in adjacent materials, just to make sure we weren't overloading that structure. But in terms of the bearing, the pin bearing itself, we haven't monitored that.
Thank you.
Okay. As a committee, we focused a lot of attention, inevitably, on the issue concerning the truss end link member and the seizure of the pin. Given the limitations that each of you have outlined this morning in terms of structural health monitoring, can I ask you the question that I asked Barry Colford, the former Bridgemaster, at the Fourth Road Bridge last week, which was, do you believe that the issue could have been foreseen? And perhaps, Mr. Hill, you'd like to kick off.
The referring right back to the start of the questions with regards to a risk-based inspection, if we monitored every single element and every single joint, it's possible that a very detailed analysis of the information from every point of the bridge could give some indication of some trouble in some part of the bridge, but it would be a huge exercise. Particularly with suspension bridges, it's a web of elements. Again, particularly with the Fourth Road trusses, it is a whole web of elements. And the action of one part of that web being restrained or moving slightly differently to that it was designed to do so would be an enormous task to monitor and to determine what the results might be.
I'm not sure if that was a yes, a no, or a maybe.
it's,
if you come it, back to that, if you like.
It is. It's obviously I'm having difficulty answering it with a definitive yes or no. The amount of data mining which would be necessary that could perhaps give the information that would point you to a specific element causing distress would suggest a very large team of people looking at the results 24 hours a day. So it may be possible, it probably isn't practical or economically viable.
Okay. Mr. Fish, same question.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. It's very difficult to divorce hindsight from all of this because we know what's happened, and but winding the clock back a couple of months and saying, you know, could that have been anticipated and avoided? Part of the structural performance monitoring, which I know is on Forth, mostly geared at the cables, but also gives an indication of deflections in the main truss. That could have been used to say, well, actually, what is going on with the articulation at the bridge? And if, sort of coming to the conclusion that the pintles and the linkages were the, as I've described earlier, potential hotspot in terms of a problem, then an inspection regime would only say, well, okay, well, there's potentially an issue with this whole element. What it would not necessarily do would conclude that the failure that happened, which, you know, with the fracture in the metal above the pin, that would have been the outcome. With hindsight, you know, you can say, well, yes, that should have been examined, that should have been looked at. Some analysis should have been done to see what the loads were going to be in the end posts on the truss. But I said to the other fellow witnesses beforehand, you know, the irony to me of all of this is that Forth is one of the most well-managed bridges in the whole of the UK. And I've got a huge regard for Barry Colford. He had such a thorough understanding of that bridge. It would seem unlikely that something would be overlooked, and I would have thought at the very least, again, you know, that those issues would have been addressed. I'm sorry, that's not a yes or no answer either, and I apologise for that.
Okay, Mr. Evans.
Again, if I may, Mr. Convener, my experience of this sort of thing is that when those joints begin to jam up, there's usually evidence from things like noise. That's always what we go and look for. And as far as I can tell from all that's been said here, there was no evidence of creaking or groaning. And for those who don't know, if this kind of thing happens on that structure, it resonates through the whole structure. You know, it's very loud noises. And as far as I know, there's been no report of that. I would add that if the pin jammed up and there are internal stresses on the connection between the fabricated bit and the pin itself, again, you get no evidence of that. And what happens is that an imperfection, I won't call it a defect, but an imperfection becomes overstressed, and you can get a very sudden failure, and it transfers across the weld line and into the material very quickly. So it's my experience that you wouldn't have found this until it was there.
So I think that's a fairly definitive no then. Okay, thank you, David.
You covered my question on structural health monitoring, but can I perhaps look at a different angle? I mean, is it fair to say that structural health monitoring is not a sort of silver bullet that's going to solve every problem that you have on the bridge? And I think some of the witnesses have already identified, it's very expensive to do this. Secondly, it's very expensive on staff time, and you could well have staff monitoring screens 24 hours a day, which is a huge cost to the organisation. I mean, is that a fair point, Mr. Evans?
I think it is. And, you know, you've got to add one other thing, that, that the people looking at the data have got to be experienced enough to understand what they're seeing.
Yeah. OK, Mr. Fish?
Yeah, I agree. The big difference between what you want to get out of structural performance monitoring, structural health monitoring, is the translation from data to information. You can get bombarded with millions and millions of bits of data. That's got to be interpreted. So the more recent developments in structural performance monitoring have led to a lot of what's called a sort of post-processing element. So there's the structure is modelled in a finite element or a structural analysis point of view, and the performance is compared, what's going on the bridge is compared to what the computer model says. Mm-hmm. And as soon as there's a difference between what's going on the bridge and on the computer model, then the lights flash and the bells ring, and that's providing you the information. So you're not necessarily having to go through vast amounts of data. Mm. That is in an embryonic stage. I'm not aware of any...
Okay.
A lot of bridges are putting structural health,
yeah,
structural performance monitoring on from new, but that post-processing is what's actually needed to turn data into information.
That seems to make a lot of sense. So that would be some form of exceptions warning.
Exactly, yes.
Yeah. So, I mean, obviously, as you know, the new bridge is going to have some of that. Mm-hmm. But obviously, a new bridge has got up-to-date design in the sense it probably doesn't need it as much as a bridge that was built in 1964. Are you aware, in terms of best practice across the world, of much retrofitting that's gone on in bridges to, you know, to put in structural health monitoring because of any particular problems?
A lot of retrofitting has gone on. Like you intimated... it's a lot easier to put a system into a new bridge, design it in from the outset, and a lot of new structures being built at the moment have inbuilt health monitoring systems and a lot of data collection. It's not so quite so easy to retrofit, especially with older bridges, because you don't really know what's gone on in its history in terms of what's already... had some effect on it. You know, some elements have moved due to creep or shrinkage, and then you're applying a system after such movements have taken place, so you're not getting necessarily the full picture. But the retrofitting is going on a lot, but you still fall into the same trap of having vast amount of data and not necessarily the information.
That's an interesting point. Thanks. Mr. Hill, do you have anything to add?
I can only really reiterate the comments that have come across there, that I think absolutely with new bridges, it's very sensible and worthwhile to install the equipment capable of monitoring the structure. Even if at the moment we don't have 100% credible methods for analysing that data, there is still the risk that I referred to it earlier as data mining, just the collection of data which no one knows what to do with. But undoubtedly, it is always an improving picture. So it's certainly something valid for new bridges.
I think Mr. Evans' point's a useful one about abnormal noise was a factor raised. So I suppose the sort of non-engineering view I would have is that you can have all the structural health warning monitoring you want, but you shouldn't forget about the day-to-day common sense thing of looking at noise and the visual inspection as well.
And these are certainly why we have a range of inspection protocols, even though generally, as for the big bridges, we don't subscribe to the fixed general inspection and principal inspection. We still would expect our inspectors to report unusual noises. Having a team that's dedicated to the structure, that know the structure inside and out, as I know Barry Colford's team did, I think is still an essential thing to have.
Can I stick with you for my next question, Mr. Hill? The committee have been told that the truss end links at the Humber Bridge have been replaced recently. Can you describe when the problem was identified, what the problem was, and when the work was completed?
Certainly. These were not truss end links. They were called A-frames, which were torsional and rotational members for the Humber Bridge.
sorry, just to, for the layman and woman watching this and committee as well, can you perhaps just explain the difference between
just,
the two?
Just briefly, of course, with a suspension bridge, they don't have conventional bearings. The loads aren't transferred from the deck down to supports under the bridge. They're transferred up to the cables. But nevertheless, if you leave the ends of the bridge free to rotate, they could actually twist in midair, both horizontally, vertically and laterally. So there needs to be a restraint there to stop those movements. Theoretically, they don't take vertical load. In reality, of course, they do, because they are structural elements, they are there, therefore they take load. Those are the elements that we replaced at the Humber Bridge.
Okay.
Whereas the truss end links for the fourth bridge were expected to take load and also restrain the bridge in the different directions. Mm-hmm. So our replacement was for these A-frames, as they were called, and it was first identified that these were wearing in around 2005, or a little bit before that even. But it was identified because they had been moving and they had worn. Without getting too technical, the pins themselves travel through bushes, which were specially machined to allow the rotation. With these pins, the pins themselves were actually grooved to allow grease to be forced into them to facilitate that rotation.
Just so we're clear as well, in the case of the Humber Bridge, are the pins visible? So you could detect this with a visual inspection?
The ends of the pins could be made visible. There were cover plates on, but we had cover plates that we could remove to see them. You still won't detect any rotation by sitting there looking at them, because it's, again, microscopic. However, the pins, it was subsequently found, had locked into the bush. So a similar form of failure to the fourth, perhaps. But the bushes themselves had then rotated within the A-frames, causing the wear, and which became visible, which was the indication of the failure.
And was this picked up at one of the standard inspections, or was it because of some exceptional issue in the bridge that you picked up?
This failure didn't cause a significant issue in terms of serviceability or operation of the bridge. Mm. It was picked up through inspection, the visible wearing of the of the hole and dropping of the A-frame structure.
Right, thank you. That's very helpful. And perhaps if I can turn to Mr. Fish and Mr. Evans, do you know whether similar work has been carried out, the Tamar or the Severn Bridge?
Go first on the Tamar. Tamar went through a quite elaborate strengthening and widening project in the late 90s, early 2000s. And that involved a lot of works with supplementary cables and replacing a concrete deck with a steel orthotropic plate. And in the process of doing that, obviously the analysis looked at the existing linkages, the pentals, and it was deemed that no work was required. So that was a major milestone in the history of Tamar Bridge, doing all that work. And if the work had been needed, it would have been done at that point. So nothing has been done subsequent to that.
Yeah. Mr. Evans?
I think I've already briefly touched on what was done at Severn. And to follow the train of thought, the structural analysis indicated that the inner links were overstressed or would be overstressed under the new loadings. That meant that we designed the outer links to a new standard, and therefore we didn't actually suffer problems. But when we took them apart, we did find wear in the bushes. They were bushed, but I'm not absolutely sure about this, but I think that they were a kind of bush that is self-lubricating. I think it's sintered bronze or something. I think that's what it was called. But they were definitely wearing.
And my final question to all the witnesses, based on your engineering experience, do you have any comments you'd like to make on the specific failure on the Forth Road Bridge? Mr. Evans?
I think I said earlier, I suspect that this happened between the two inspections, the May inspection and the when it occurred, when it was picked up in early December. And because of the nature of steel, any imperfection that starts to grow grows very quickly.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Fish. I certainly support what John has just said. I think the other point to remember is in the time that Forth was being, the steel for Forth was being fabricated, steel quality wasn't the quality that it is now. Mm. And certainly when Tamar was a little bit earlier, Tamar was finished in 1961, Forth 64. When we were doing the work on the Tamar Bridge and looking at the existing steel, it was very mixed. There were some areas where there were a lot of impurities, holes, thin blow pipes in the steel itself. And the quality of the steel cannot be guaranteed. So I'm not saying that was a factor here, but it's something that should be recognised, that steel quality perhaps wasn't quite the same as it was in the 60s as it is now.
In very simple terms, could you explain why there's been such a change in steel quality from the 60s to present day?
I think a lot of it was building up the industry post-war and increasing the levels of quality control through the 70s and 80s. There was a demand for steel after the war, and perhaps it was more important to produce quantity rather than quality.
And that wouldn't necessarily just be a UK thing, because I know from the current bridge, a lot of the steel's from China, wasn't it, and France?
Yes. Well, that's don't get me started on Chinese steel.
Well, without making... Yeah, we could certainly have done with more domestic steel on the basis of that, but...
Inquiry, although it would be an interesting diversion.
Another day.
I would similarly agree that this sort of a failure, if it happened in the way that some believe it did, would occur very quickly, particularly in a material of perhaps unknown quality.
And would you echo Mr. Fisher's comments about variable steel quality?
Certainly in the past in the UK, we believe even the Chinese steel now is manufactured to a much better standard than perhaps it has been referred to in the past.
Right. Okay, thank you. And I'm very conscious of getting told off by the convener to go into steel inquiry, so I will leave it in that. Adam.
Yeah, briefly want to talk about the response to the failure. As Mr. Evans pointed out, the truss end link was seen to have failed on the 1st of December. And the bridge was closed and it reopened to all traffic except HGVs on the 22nd. Do you think this is a reasonable time to carry out the emergency work? And from what you know about the repair work, was this an appropriate solution?
I'm absolutely confident that it was a remarkable achievement. I've only come into this since the event, and I've been following what's been going on. And to deal with all 16 end links in that time, in those conditions, in the middle of the winter and in the middle of the fourth, dealing with the old steels that we discussed, all these things, it's been a remarkable achievement.
Okay. And in terms of you think it was an appropriate solution that was engineered?
Yes. I have to say that, one of my disciplines is welding. And I would have been very nervous about welding on those steels. We've discussed the age of them and the quality of them. I might have gone for a bolted solution. Mm-hmm. But, they appear to have achieved what they set out to do.
Mr. Fish, Mr. Hill?
I would echo John's comments entirely. I think we were sent some outline drawings of the solution, which I thought was very innovative, practical, easy to build, and the time that it's been done, I think, is exemplary. Absolutely no criticism at all of the outcome or the time taken to deliver it.
It needs to be tempered, obviously, with the it may not prove to be a permanent solution. I don't know myself, but it does seem that the team working on that came up with an excellent solution and installed it very, very promptly. I was certainly impressed.
Thank you for those observations. Can I ask, from your own experience, have you ever closed a bridge that you are responsible for, the Humber, the Tamar, or the Severn, to all traffic?
About 12 hours ago, actually. actually, due to the high winds on Tuesday night, I was actually on the Humber Bridge at Monday night, sorry, at 10:30. With a full closure in place. But this wasn't for a structural issue. It was the fact we had, unfortunately, a vehicle overturned.
Right. Okay.
Again, yes, for operational reasons, have had to close the bridge. Again, not for structural reasons, either for suicide incidents or, again, vehicles turning over, vehicles breaking down. But nothing from a structural point of view.
My experience is that we managed to strengthen the whole of the Severn crossing, that's not just the Severn, but the Y Bridge, with only 2 4-hour closures in the middle of one night, complete closures. But we've had the same wind incidents. But the other ones that the other one that the committee will be aware of was when the Erskine Bridge was hit by an oil rig.
Yeah.
And I spent the next 6 weeks on site with emergency repairs. And of course we had to, the first week I think it was, we had to close the bridge until we were satisfied that we weren't going to get a complete failure, catastrophic collapse of the structure. But then it led into all the difficulties of controlling the traffic. And you might remember that went on for quite a few months.
Yes. So, in summary, then, a closure like this would be a very rare event, and it begs the question, in your opinion, could it have been foreseen and prevented?
I don't think you would have foreseen, I think we discussed it, foreseen what the particular failure was, but the idea of having contingency measures in place for when something catastrophic happens might be looked at in the future. You know, the obvious thing straight away was to stop the heavies, because it's very difficult to control heavy goods. They tend to go in gaggles, which is the very thing we don't want on the loading of bridges.
Yeah.
But diversion routes and that kind of thing are not uncommon these days, pre-planned. Diversion routes. Lessen the impact, but you wouldn't stop the problem.
Yeah, there's a cause and effect thing here, isn't there? The cause, as we've discussed, would have been very difficult to predict. The effect, as in the closure of the bridge, obviously that was taken not as a light decision, and safety of the travelling public, absolute paramount. I wouldn't question the that decision made by the engineers who are at the sharp end and faced with that sort of issue. And I don't have the evidence to say, well, could the bridge have been kept open with just 2 lanes running instead of 4? I don't know. But the decision had to be taken around public safety.
Yeah. Okay. I could only say that knowing the competencies of the team with Barry Colford, I can't see that this incident could have been otherwise determined or pre-warned in any other practical way. As to the subsequent actions of the team that are now looking after the bridge and reacted to this emergency, it seems to have been entirely appropriate.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen, for that. Can I perhaps switch to consideration of future maintenance, repair and strengthening works? Are there lessons to be learned elsewhere from the experience on the 4th?
I think it's certainly, as a bridge community around the world, and we do have quite a strong international community sharing information, and most of our maintenance programmes are based on information shared around the world. I believe the 4th Bridge had a similar type of full maintenance plan to myself. I actually look forward at I have a 60-year major maintenance programme, which is informed by similar structures throughout the world. Now, of course, 60 years is actually an impossible time to look ahead for maintenance. The intention behind that is just to make sure we identify the areas of risk, the elements we know that have had to be maintained on similar structures around the world, and make sure they're there in the programme to be addressed at an appropriate time.
Okay. I think the key point is around linking the inspections to the maintenance, so that you're actually determining when to intervene in a maintenance sense. If you compare, well, it may not be a strict comparison, but if you compare the 4th Bridge to a Formula One car, the ideal thing for a Formula One car is that as soon as it crosses the finishing line, all the components fail. So that's its design life. That's what it's intended to do. So every component of that car is given a design life, and structures and bridges are exactly the same, only you obviously want to have some sort of contingency and reassurance. So you are able to look at the results of inspections, look at the results of structural performance monitoring, and come up with a regime of maintenance intervention, which would say, well, actually, at this point, it would be a very sensible thing to do to replace cable band bolts, as an example, because I know that has been done on 4th, because you don't want it to fail, obviously. So, but there's an intervention point somewhere ahead of failure. As for lessons to be learned, an international suspension bridge conference this June, and I would very much hope that the lessons of 4th will be able to be, and I assume that would be down to Transport Scotland if they're willing to release that information. But the four big suspension bridges in the UK, there may be about 400 in the States and around the world, and it's vital for those owners to actually learn the lessons from 4th, as well as those of us in the UK.
If I may add, Convener, the one lesson I would take from this is that these end links are an element that it appears to me that one could provide an alternative load path, as we did on 7. I mean, the reason we did it on 7 was a different reason, and we were lucky to be able to do it. But I would think that it'd be an idea to have in mind a way of dealing with any failure of any one link.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Clear.
Good morning. I'd like to ask a little bit about the capital planning for the bridge and how you would capital plan in your own areas. And we've had some terminology in the committee. I think the engineers mentioned a wish list that they always had. FETA had provided an indicative capital plan, and also there's committed projects at any one time. Can you just maybe shed some light on what your understanding of those terms are? And how long do you have a capital plan in place for your bridges yourselves?
I have to say first, I know that Barry Colford wouldn't refer to it as a wish list. Just as we all do, we recognise that there are financial constraints on maintenance. We don't have an infinite pot. However, we do need to look to the future and identify projects that may or may not, subject to inspection, require undertaking. My own maintenance plan, I've just referred to, is actually over 60 years. Now, for the Humber Bridge, that's actually such a long extent because we're still working to repay the capital debt for construction of the bridge, which has around 30 years to run. And I was looking at a programme of maintenance to at least double that timescale. That's why I'm working on 60 years. Probably a more reasonable return period for maintenance for someone without that type of constraint is probably around 20 years. Again, it's still impossible to really look into the future for 20 years as to what will be necessary. However, it's important to make sure that both for operational and serviceability reasons to keep the bridge fit and safe for purpose, that we're aware of the projects that are likely to become necessary to at least consider, based on experience from around the global community, and make appropriate planning for those, both in terms of making sure we don't end up with a huge amount of work all to do in 1 year, so it can be spaced out, but also in terms of the financial outlay that's necessary for that work.
Tamar, we used to work to horizons of 5 and 10 and 15 years. but that was very fluid, because if something came along in terms of an issue discovered during an inspection, then obviously that programme would have to change. Broadly, you could separate things into essential and desirable. And interventions themselves, some things can be put off, and the obvious one is painting. You know, if you can put a painting scheme off for a year or 2 years or 5 years, the bridge won't collapse, but the intervention you're going to have to make at that future point is likely to be more expensive. So there's a sort of fine balancing act between getting the priorities and determining the most efficient way of managing and maintaining the bridge. But every structure of any size, really, and if you get into smaller structures, it's treated as a bridge stock rather than an individual bridge. But you would have to have a capital plan, long-term plan, as I said, fairly fluid, linked around the optimum time for maintenance interventions. And that's how you would plan your budget. Now, the big question, and it's clearly as much a political question as it is an engineering question, you know, does the budget drive the maintenance, or does the maintenance drive the budget? And I know which way around I would want it to be, but I'm in the real world as well.
My experience is slightly different. I can't tell what happened with the Severn Bridge between the end of the construction in 66 and when the strengthening started in the 80s. It was in the hands of a local authority during that period, and I don't know how they budgeted. And then, of course, once we moved into the strengthening works, all that was costed. It was competitive tendering, so the funds were provided by government. Once it moved into the concession period, there's another set of considerations there. The key consideration that you're talking about is that at the end of the concession period, whatever that is, it's either temporal or financial, the bridge is to be handed back to the owner, the government, in the condition that it was intended to be. So it starts its life again. And whoever takes over after that, we don't know at the moment. But they will obviously have to have some financial plan, budget, and then there will be the usual financial constraints on that. But hopefully they will know more clearly what they've got to allow for in the way of inspection and maintenance.
In terms of your annual budget for running the bridges, do you have any capital reserves or contingency funds there in case the unforeseen happens? And can you give me an idea of what level of those reserves would be in an annual budget?
Certainly with the Tamar maintenance budgets, there always were reserves for contingencies. I can't recall what the level was in proportion, but effectively there would be a revenue budget for operation and management of the structure. There would be a capital budget for planned maintenance, and that also you'd need to have a budget as well for reactive maintenance, and that may have been taken from the reserves or it may have been at the expense of other planned maintenance. But I'm sorry, I don't know the detail of the level of the reserves in proportion to the overall budget.
Thank you.
At the Humber, we do hold a small reserve, but generally that's incorporated within our major maintenance fund, because many of the projects are on a bridge the size of the Humber are big projects. Just because of the size of the bridge, they cost significantly more than we can actually collect in any one year. So we have a maintenance fund from which we build up, looking at the major maintenance programme, so that it can be expended at the appropriate time. If there are any contingent works need undertaking, we'll often take it from that fund and then increase payments over subsequent years to bring it back up to the level we need for future projects.
Can you just tell me what you would understand the difference to be work essential to maintain the long-term integrity of the bridge and safety critical work, and what would have happened if this had been identified as safety critical?
Safety critical is quite an unusual term. Safety, I would recognise as being one of the paramount elements which we consider in terms of prioritising works. We obviously look at the risk of failure and the consequences of failure in any risk-based assessment, and that's both in terms of the financial consequences, the operational consequences, all the consequences for safety of any failure. And that would help prioritise work at the bridge.
Anybody else want to comment on that?
I'm not party to the shareholders, the concessionaire shareholding, but I suspect that they are big enough not to specifically identify reserves, but they're big enough to provide anything that's necessary to meet their commercial obligations.
Okay. Can I just ask if, in terms of capital planning and long-term capital planning, was it reasonable to review the non-committed projects in light of the decision to build the new fourth crossing?
I'll say yes.
I knowing the little bit of the history around both of the new and the old fourth road bridges, and I would say that you had to look at the two in the round. The similarities with Severn are fairly strong, and you had an existing bridge and then building a new alongside. The process through which it's delivered is very different, but you have to take a couple of steps back, and so we'll look at the future transport links across the Forth, and I don't think you can separate the two.
I think I ought to clarify for you there that Richard may not know, but the strengthening of Severn was decided before the second crossing was on the cards. It was the only link.
From a public governance of funding perspective, I'm sure it would be appropriate to consider the maintenance on one structure with an adjacent new structure. I wouldn't like to say that was actually done, because obviously I don't know.
And finally, as a result of the review that FET undertook, they identified a trial repair to actually the bit of the truss end link they were worried about, which is not the bit that were that broke and closed the bridge. Have you been able to look at that repair and identify that as a reasonable repair strategy for the future of the truss end links at that point?
I personally have very limited knowledge. I'm aware of what was undertaken, but the actual mechanism of loads there, I'm afraid I don't know enough about to comment on.
Yeah, I've seen the copies of the original drawing, so I understand how it worked. I don't know anything about what was proposed in terms of repair.
Again, I've only got a superficial knowledge, but I can say that it's not unusual to do a trial when you're going to adopt something, if you can do a trial. And I would have thought that it was reasonable to do the trial, find out all the bugs before you lash into it.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Convener. I think some of the questions I was intending to ask have already been covered, but just taking you back a wee bit, I'm quite interested in this, the inspection regime and how you go about that. And, in the absence of some of the, high-tech kind of solutions that may now be available, it seems to me that, from what I understand, primarily you're talking about a visual inspection, and I think Mr. Evans talked about sound, and that kind of makes sense to me. I know a mechanic that can diagnose faults from an engine just by listening to it. Am I correct in saying that as you undertake the inspection, the inspections, it's, in the absence of any sound, it's a visual inspection, and you're looking for stress cracks or that kind of defect. So it would tend to be, almost a kind of binary thing. This element I'm inspecting looks okay, or it doesn't look okay, and that's the best that kind of inspection can deliver as it's currently practiced. Am I correct in that?
Yeah, I would say you are correct. A lot of it is down to the experience of the engineer or the bridge inspector. The most useful tool I take when I do bridge inspections is a hammer. It's back to the sound issue again. You tap, whether it's a bit of masonry or a bit of metal, there's a sound to it which gives you confidence that that's intact. Once you find an issue, then you would be a bit more intrusive and look for try and define the problem a bit more. But first sight, it is visual inspection with the experience of the inspector and a bit of brute force occasionally.
Yeah. Thank you. That's very useful, I think. Just touching, going back on this, tension, I suppose, between, the budget, nobody's got an absolutely open-ended budget, and between, ongoing maintenance and repairs and so on. How would you prioritise projects that maybe, couldn't all be carried out within a budget? How would you allocate that priority?
I think we've sort of touched on this concept of safety critical. Again, I'm a bit nervous about using that term. I mean, to me, safety critical means that if it fails, the whole structure fails. It's not just an operational failure where you might have to close the bridge. If you come across one of truly safety critical, there's no option. You've got to go in and do it. And somebody's got to find the money for sorting it out. With other things, it's as Richard says, I mean, there's painting you can put off, surfacing to an extent you can put off, up to a point, because there are standards, even in surfacing, the road condition. Elements like a jamming up of an expansion joint, you've just got to do something with it straight away. And somebody has got to find the money, either from a commercial organisation or from central funds. you know, it just puts the structure out of operation.
Yeah, yeah. That leads me very nicely, actually, into my final couple of questions, because the committee received some written evidence from a Mr. Bob Hopewell, who was is a retired engineer who did looked after some bridges in North Ayrshire. Not on the scale of these bridges, but nevertheless, you know, with some similarities. And he said in his written submission that no public bridge authority would refuse to fund essential maintenance that was considered to present an unacceptable risk to the travelling public. Would you regard that as a generally correct statement?
Yeah, that's
absolutely. The Humber Bridge Act provides us to calls us to provide a safe method of crossing the Humber estuary for the customers.
Yeah, thank you. And just my final question now. Apologies. My final question then is, from the same chap, Bob Hopewell, he says, in my opinion, the integrity of a bridge manager would mean that it would be a resigning matter if funds were refused and the bridge were allowed to remain open against his or her recommendation. Would you agree with that statement?
I did read Mr. Hopewell's statement, and I must admit that bit did make me smile a little bit. But I think what he's saying is it's back to this shift from the engineering decision to a political decision. And if but I'm also an ex-local authority bridge engineer as well, so I do recall situations where, not because I wanted to put any pressure, but actually to say to elected members, well, actually, you have got to realise the implications of a decision around either doing a slightly reduced maintenance regime or not doing one. And I would never have gone so far as to say that's a resigning matter. I think that might be a sort of bit of a tantrum issue. But I sympathise with his sentiment, put it that way. Probably not to say that resignations would be taking place all over the country otherwise, in today's financial climate.
It's obviously been stated emotively, but I would expect anyone in that position that identifies, we'll use the term safety critical event, to make sure that no one was going to be put at risk of that. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't consider it a resigning event. I would close the bridge.
Mm. Mm. Thank you. That's very useful. Thank you.
Mr. Dew, want to add anything?
I tend to agree with what's been said. The difficulty about closing the bridge is that you've got to have responsibility. Peter has total responsibility. The concessionaire at Severn at the moment, I would say, has as good as got total responsibility. But unless it was actually a structural failure, they would talk to the Department of Transport, the Welsh Government, before they actually said, we've got to close the bridge.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. That's been very useful.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Hill, if I heard you correctly, I think you talked earlier about the risks of failure and the consequences of failure. It was yourself that said that, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. We heard in evidence last week from Mr. Colford on the subject of risk management what appeared to sound like a hierarchy of risk, with the most, this phrase that I know people are hesitating to use, the most safety critical being the safety of the users of the bridge, that's to say the travelling public and the people who operate the bridge, the long-term structural integrity of the bridge, and then the operational safety of the bridge. Is that a fair characterisation?
It is. I feel if there was any situation that presented itself with a significant danger to life and limb, then that risk, the consequences of that risk are obviously would be uppermost in consideration of action.
Okay.
The long-term integrity of the bridge, obviously, they might seem, you might come across an incident where the long-term viability of the structure is critical. But there are often more than one way to skin a cat in that sort of scenario. So it may be appropriate to pause. And certainly if it's just a matter that inconveniences the public or the operator, that would be a lesser consequence.
Okay. Mr. Fish?
Certainly I would agree that there is the hierarchy in terms of risk management. Risk you define by the likelihood of a risk occurring and the consequences of occurring. That presents quite an objective way of rationalising and prioritising those risks. And the sorts of hierarchy that you said, convener, that Mr. Colford stated, I would agree with. That's quite appropriate.
Okay. Mr. Evans?
I think I would just add one thing, which is that we've also got to take cognizance of the emergency services, because they come into this equation, but they're dealing with the operation on the carriageway, as it were, and it might not be particularly structurally important, but they certainly can intervene and close the bridge to traffic.
Okay, thank you for that. We heard earlier from Claire Adamson about the indicative capital plan, and we've had a bit of a discussion about how you prioritise maintenance works within the budgetary constraints within which you have to operate. And clearly, part of our discussion as a committee, part of our inquiry has been around the postponement of a particular piece of work, which was the replacement of the entire truss end link assembly, which had been costed at an estimated £10 to £15 million. Now, I just wondered if you had a perspective based on your own engineering experience and what you have learned about what has happened historically at the Forth Road Bridge, about whether the decisions that were taken would be ones that would be consistent with the hierarchy of risk that we've just been discussing. In other words, were the correct decisions made to postpone capital maintenance works?
I think it's, as Barry Goldford once said, it's a fairly hypothetical question now. We know what's failed, but I don't think anybody at the time thought that these particular links were going to fail. That's the bottom. As far as the overloaded upper brackets were concerned and the consequences of those, with my limited knowledge from reading and seeing what's happened in the last few days, I don't think that was an unreasonable decision to go for the trial and then see what came out of that compared to that £10 to £15 million budget for the whole thing.
Okay, so there was a risk, but it was an operational risk. Would that be a fair assessment?
In effect, yes.
Okay. Yeah.
I can say that I have certainly in the past reprioritised work, looking at it not only in terms of the cost to smooth out the cost profile, but also in terms of the practicality of undertaking work with other works going on the bridge at the same time. You can't start cutting several structural elements at once, so sometimes there's a need to reprioritise on that basis. And certainly if the consequences of the risk appear to be only the serviceability of the bridge rather than a critical risk to the bridge, it's perfectly reasonable to do so.
Okay. Mr. Fish, do you have a perspective on this?
I would, again, endorse what the others have said. I would also add that in any maintenance budget that there are going to be pressures from the amount of money in the budget for one, pressures from other maintenance needs, other interventions that need to be carried out, and that's that balancing act. But I think with hindsight, you could say, well, obviously that shouldn't have been removed from the programme, but at the time, with reducing budget and increasing demands elsewhere, that was quite an understandable decision to take.
Okay, thank you. Siobhan.
Convener, just on the conversation you've just been having, how involved would the board be in accessing that money to prioritise? In your experience of your bridge, how involved would the board have been in that?
In a sense, this is the political dimension I assume you're referring to. So the board would be the ones who would make the final decision at the recommendation of the engineer or the bridge master, whoever is making that point of view. Quite what that relationship is, I don't really know. There needs to be that element of trust. You can't have the board on the one hand saying that, you know, they have priorities to maintain the bridge if they're not going to allocate funds to do that. So, and they also have to have an implicit trust in the engineering side from the bridge manager.
Is that your experience of your bridge?
Yes, this is very much so. So, in other words, what I'm coming around to is it's almost becomes a joint decision. Both have got to recognise the territory in which the other one operates, mm-hmm. but at the same time, there's a real world, and either the board has got to sign up to what the engineer says, or we're in the position that, you know, Mr. Hopewell was describing earlier on.
Seven crossings, again, are slightly different, but trying to draw the closest parallel, the concessionaire is ultimately responsible during the concession period, but there is a government representative who oversees, or we talk about, somebody talked about light touch. I hate the idea, but I was government representative for some years, and during that period, if the concessionaire wanted to do something which was out with the envisaged work from the maintenance and inspection manual and all the other volumes of the concession agreement, we were in a position to say, no, you can't do it. But we would only do that if we really felt that it was something unwise, totally unwise for the bridge. So there was somebody just behind the board overseeing it.
And I suppose in that example, and to go back to the conversation again, previous, was about if there was critical work, you know, and it was, and Mr. Hopewell saying, you know, mm-hmm. if that hadn't been guaranteed and the safety was compromised, then it's a resigning matter. If, in that instance with the people behind and the board, if the money wasn't allocated because you had spent your allocation for that year or 3 years, 5 years, whatever it may be, and yet this, again, safety critical work came up, who would ultimately be responsible for sanctioned funds? How do you generate those funds, given that safety is the impact but the money's not there? How would that work in those scenarios?
Again, my experience is slightly unusual, and I think that the shareholders have got a very high conscience as to the safety of the travelling public, mm-hmm. and they would find the funds.
In the case of government? Or?
Well, either that government would have to intervene, or government gives permission to borrow, and you know the funds are found through borrowing.
And would local authorities be involved in that at any point, or simply government?
Tamar was a sort of unusual case, and it was managed, but it was a joint committee. It was similar to FETA in a way, but it was a joint committee of two local authorities. But in order to do the strengthening and widening works that were carried out, we did need additional funds, and so those two local authorities subsidised that through their own reserves. But that's the equivalent of going to say a central government, Scottish government, or Westminster government.
And on that work, because I was coming on to that, Mr. Fish, how was that budgeted for at the beginning? How was it prioritised for? Do you know, who were the partners in that?
It's trying to keep a long story short, but the bridge also is a joint undertaking with a ferry operation, using chain ferries across the Tamar. And they had a reserve to replace those ferries, ultimately. And this was a classic decision taken jointly about two crossings again, where you could actually defer the ferry replacement. So that money was shifted to the bridge. So that gave us a capital allowance. The The Tamar Bridge was told during the works and before the works, so we were able to source a fairly static toll income. So we actually started doing the strengthening work, hesitate to say, without enough money in the bank to finish it. So we had to keep the bridge open to traffic, doing all the work, collected the tolls, and when we just went into the red for a period of about 6 months to the tune of about £2 million, and that was, as I said, funded by the two parent authorities under a fairly loose borrowing arrangement. But it was if we hadn't had facility to charge tolls, and this was the issue going to central government, because we went to central government for funding initially, and their response was, no, you charge tolls, there's your income, you use that to pay. So all of these structures are very similar, but all very different, certainly in terms of governance and in and in funding situations.
Well, it's certainly complicated.
Yes.
That's very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Do members have any further questions, Mr. Alex?
Yes, I was going to explore something in dangerous territory I got into last week, but I'm going to try it again just briefly. The work was deferred on the truss end links, and that work was associated with the opposite end of the link and a part which has not failed. Had that work been carried out when it was originally mooted, would it have led to either the discovery of a problem in the area that failed, or maintenance to that area which would have prevented the problem?
I'm afraid I've got to say it would be impossible to say without a far more detailed understanding of the mechanism.
The question which I intended to ask after that is, how often in the maintenance of a major structure do you find yourself in a position where planned maintenance work leads to additional maintenance work which may immeasurably defer cost or danger in the longer term? How integrated is the process? Can it be separated into its individual parts?
In theory, yes. In practice, hardly ever. I think, almost certainly. When you decide, right, I'm going to do some work, and you're actually undertaking that work on an assumption as to what the problem is. Once you start, then you get the reality of what the problem is. And fourth, cable investigations is a classic point. You know, that had to be done in order to determine the problem, which then led into other maintenance interventions, such as the dehumidification to help resolve that. So I think the same would have applied had the investigation started at the tower connection rather than the truss connection. So you don't know where that might have led. That might have led to an analysis which actually said, well, actually the problem's not up here, it's down the bottom. But who's to say? The one word answer is possibly.
I have to say, I'd suggest it's fairly unusual for that to happen, for planned works to then uncover unknowns. Mm-hmm. Because we do tend to plan these works over a significant period of time. We investigate what the impact may be on other structural elements and plan for those. So it's actually quite rare that we start with one problem and find half a dozen others. We might not find what we were expecting in certain elements, which leads on to a different solution, but not other things we weren't aware of, if you like.
I might be able again to give a sort of parallel here. At the beginning of the concession period, there was a joint inspection by the potential concessionaires and the government's representative staff, my staff. And that joint inspection was intended to flag up anything that might need to be done during the concession period. And after that, the only thing that could get the concession extra money was something that couldn't have been found during that inspection. You might say that that's a kind of government backed reserve. Equally, as far as the strengthening works were concerned, which was a competitive tender, as I've said, there was a large, there was a sort of 10 to 12% contingency sum, not all of which was spent. But we knew once we got into the work in deep detail, we would find things that we hadn't seen before.
So is it in the nature of maintenance that the unforeseen will be found if you maintain, and that as a consequence, if you defer maintenance, there is an element of risk?
I think there's a larger element of risk if you defer maintenance.
Mm-hmm. I think the risk of head in the sand and not knowing what's going on is far greater than having a maintenance regime which can at least give you an indication. But just another point as an aside, the whole issue around some of these maintenance works, when you don't really know the extent of the problem, is actually arriving at an estimate for budgetary purposes right from the outset. And that's why I understand, I think the convener said that, you know, the estimate was between 10 and 15 million.
Explored that
now, someone week. Might say, gosh, that's a big range, but you just don't know until you actually start work. So hence, building in a contingency is a very sensible thing to do when you're actually developing budgets for maintenance.
Thank you for indulging me.
Not at all. I think that was a very helpful line of questioning. Are there any further questions that members have? Are there any final points that any of our witnesses would like to place on the record?
I would like to reiterate what I said at the beginning, that I'm amazed at how much has been accomplished in such a short time. I know a huge amount of resource was put in, but it still was a major effort, and all involved are to be congratulated.
Okay, thank you for that.
I would certainly endorse that, and I think it's a very healthy thing for this committee to be conducting its inquiry, because I'm sure the impact was felt very hard in the travelling public here in Scotland, but it was national and international news as far as the bridge community was concerned. And actually, as John's described, you know, what was a potential problem was turned into a success in very quick time. So, well done to those concerned, and also to your and your committee for conducting this inquiry.
Thank you.
And thank you for the invitation to come along and talk to you.
It appears that you have the last word, Mr. Hill.
Yes, I can only really build on what the other two have said and assure the, you that this discussion is going to go on internationally for quite some time. As Richard referred to, we do have the meeting of the ICSPOC, the conference, which I expect Barry will be attending as well, and I'm sure we'll discuss it there.
Okay. Thank you very much. And can I just thank, on behalf of the committee, our witnesses for making their considerable experience and expertise available to the committee this morning. It has been invaluable in informing our work as we take this inquiry forward. I thank the witnesses for their attendance, and I now suspend this meeting briefly to allow the witnesses to leave the room. Thank you.
This meeting of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, agenda item 3, subordinate legislation. The third item for today is the consideration of a negative instrument, Public Contracts Scotland Regulations 2015, SSI 2015/446. Paper 5 summarises the purpose and prior consideration of this instrument. Members may wish to note that the committee will receive an update from the Cabinet Secretary for Infrastructure, Investment and Cities on the whole suite of secondary legislation in relation to public procurement reform when it considers the draft affirmative instrument, the Procurement Scotland Regulations 2016, at a future meeting of the committee. The committee will now consider any issues that it wishes to raise in reporting to the Parliament on this specific instrument. Members should note that no motions to annul have been received in relation to the instrument. Can I invite comments from members? David.
Thank you, Convener. As you rightly pointed out, this is a negative instrument which we need to deal with today, and there's been obviously no motions to annul. My point is I'd just like to put some comments on the record, perhaps for passing on to the Cabinet Secretary. I think the instrument is fine as far as it goes, but the big gap to me is any reference and any substantial action on tax dodging. And I support the moves by Christian Aid, SDUC, Unison and others to restrict companies who tax avoid from government procurement. And I would draw attention to members to my registrar of interest showing that I am a member of Unison. I mean, the estimates of unpaid tax is difficult to ascertain for the UK, but estimates from the group I just mentioned was around £25 billion in unpaid tax due to aggressive tax avoidance. I mean, I think we all probably want to make sure that we can secure tax justice, and I believe that the regulations as put forward to us have a big gap there. I mean, Europe's had quite a lot of positive things to say about this, and I particularly would support a European-wide tax reporting to try and ensure that large companies like Amazon don't get round domestic tax laws. So I believe that our Scottish firms, Convener, are losing out because of tax dodging, because unlike multinational firms, they are less able to use aggressive tax avoidance. We don't want to see them using aggressive tax avoidance. So finally, Convener, I believe there's clear economic, social and community benefit. Companies who wish to benefit from the public pound must pay their fair share of tax.
Thank you, Dave. I mean, I think it's helpful to have your comments on the record. I'm not entirely clear that the issue that you raise would fall within the remit either of the regulations or the primary legislation. But I think I may have a solution, which would be for us to write to the Cabinet Secretary asking him to provide further clarification on the issues that you've raised, should the committee be minded to do that. Alex, you wanted to come in?
Simply going to comment on the difference between tax avoidance and tax evasion, one being a criminal offence, the other one being a practical management issue, and note that the UK government is currently doing quite a lot to tighten up the regime and to try and close some of the doors that have been left open. That was a matter that was discussed extensively, along with one or two other significant points, at the time the bill went through Parliament. And I think we had these arguments during the passage of the bill. With the one reservation that it is something of a telephone directory of secondary legislation we're getting here, and it can be difficult sometimes to assess, but it appears to me that this regulation gives effect to the legislation as we passed it in the chamber when the bill went through, and therefore I am content with the instrument as it exists.
Okay, are there any further comments from members on this instrument? Siobhan?
Correspondence, I think all members, if I'm correct, have received something from Unison or a briefing on it. I certainly received it just as an MSP. They didn't draw my attention any specifically. And I just think the question that's in our document today was what issues should we put forward to the Parliament? And I think, you know, we should be saying that we have been approached by those out with this place with concerns, and it's not simply MSPs, it's with others. And I think that should be put on record as well.
That's helpful. Are members content then that we write to the Cabinet Secretary in advance of his appearance before this committee and ask for some further clarification on the issues that have been highlighted? Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Okay. I'll just make the point that obviously all of the issues that have been raised by members are issues that can be put directly to the Cabinet Secretary when he appears before the committee. So we'll have an opportunity to do that. Finally, is the committee agreed that it does not wish to make any recommendation in relation to this instrument?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Okay, thank you. In that case, I now move this meeting into private session.